I think the core thing about Bender that people that appeals to people the most is the fact that he can say absolutely anything that, you know, that he wants to. It's he can walking up the side of a building, like, you know, looking into a window and saying, "I get a room, you two," and the person in the room is like, "We're in a room. What, I lose some weight?" You know, it's just like one of those things where it's just he can just get away. He gets away with just so, you know, short of murder, which I think he probably has gotten away with, but we just haven't found out about it yet. But he's just able to say what's on his mind, and I think that kind of appeals to him, you know. And he's not president. The thing about the voice is, it's a combination of three things. It's every drunk at the end of a bar that's just had one too many.
So it's kind of just you better just, I don't want to hear about your problems.
You know, it's that. It's Slim Pickens from Blazing Saddles. I don't know if you guys remember. What in the hell in the wide, wide world of sports is it going on? You know. Would you like some more beans, Mr. Taggart? Woo, I'd say you boys have had enough. You know, that guy. And then when I was in university, I was in a pretty prestigious acting school at Rutgers University in New Jersey. And there was a guy, student, friend of mine. He runs a children's theater school in New Jersey, and it's great, and he's producing actors from it. My buddy named Ralph Colombino. He used to do a guy called he had a character named Charlie the Sausage Guy, and all Charlie talked about was sausages. And so, sausages are fun to have, fun haul. You can have all kinds of sausages. You can have dry sausages. You can cut up like a, you know, charcuterie. And then you can have, you know, dry sausages, sweet sausages, Italian sweet sausages, Italian hot sausages. There's all kinds of sausages. The worst. You can have all good. And he would list off, he would keep going about sausages, and it killed me. And I would spur him on to just be like, "Oh, what do you think about sausages?" And he would just start going on about sausages. So the three things, those three voices, if you put them in a blender and mix them together, you get Bender. There it is. So, you know, that's pretty much it. So that's really where the voice comes from. Well, the catchphrase, "bite my shiny metal ass," is really the one that I think everybody really loves that one. But, you know, cheese it, you know, when Bender runs away, and gosh, there's others. Bender's should not be allowed on TV. You know, the whole touching speech about how, you know, sometimes when, you know, you know Bender just gets all really sweet and wonderful, and then basically says to hit your kids, you know, just pummel them, really, which is kind of ridiculous. But everybody always has something to say, and you know, that's different. But mostly, I'm lucky because it's just straight up bite my shiny metal ass, and that gets him every time. It's just, you know, so it's kind of funny. Yeah,
one of the nicest sounds in the entire world is Bender's "I'm up to no good" laugh.
Yeah. You know what, it's funny because when I would do that, I would always crack up David X. Cohen, which is great. When you can make the boss laugh, that's always awesome. But it was just basically just like a tee hee 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 hee, like literally just like, and they just like, "Well, go for it," you know, and they, you know, sneaky laugh. They would, you know, it'd be in parentheses, sneaky laugh. So I would just, you know, I would think to myself, "Oh, sneaking around," just like, you know, just, yeah, you know, just being silly, you know. And then they had other stuff for me to do, like, you know, they would make me whistle as Bender, but they would also say, "You can't make it sound like any other song." So I had to make up like a song that didn't exist and yet not be musical about it, but whistle. So it's like, well, what kind of narrow path are you sending me? So that's why when you hear Bender whistle, and that's all it was. But that became that. Then they were just like, oh, kind of hum along. And we want you to hum along now, but don't be musical. And that was called the Bender Strut. And they would just go Bender Strut, and they would let me just do it because I came up with it. And what's great is that I got into the composers union because I wrote those. That was me that wrote those songs. So every time they get played, I get a check from ASCAP, which is like, you know, the songwriters union in the United States. I think it's here too as well. But yeah, I got a check from, you know, Bender Strut, you know, Bender Whistle. Like, yeah, a couple hundred bucks. I'm like, yeah, all right, man. Yeah, I was a songwriter. So yeah, it's pretty funny. It's interesting because he was, I mean, at the introduction of the show, he was such a narcissist and just was so self-centered. And I think him having Fry and their growing friendship, you know, throughout the show and the series, I think that changed him a lot and kind of, you know, and you know, that's one of those things about a show that gets to have the life that it had. You know, the characters will change and you know, over time and you know, grow. And I think Bender grew a lot, as far as that's concerned, about, you know, caring about other people and especially orphans. And, you know, he fell in love a bunch of times. But his growing friendship with Fry, I think, has everything to do with it. And you know, I mean, his funkometer changed, you know, his funkometer got a little more funkier as the show went on, you know, put a little more soul in it. Yeah. You know, a little, that kind of thing, you know, like, you know, when he's walking out of the courtroom, you know, after getting busted for pimping, you know, just, we love you, Bender. Shut up, baby. I know it. You know, that stuff. And that's really kind of just like, oh yeah, baby. And you know, when he's fooling around with the femputer and Amazon women on the moon, and, you know, got to fool around with Bea Arthur, you know, one of the Golden Girls, which is ridiculous. But yeah, I mean, you know, I was actually recording with Bea Arthur and telling her, oh yeah, baby, give me some of that. And you don't really normally get to do that with Bea Arthur. So that's kind of, you know, it's very funny. But yeah, Bender, yeah, his narcissism, yeah, it was totally narcissistic, but it starts to fade as the show grows. So, I mean, I love playing Bender, but my favorite character from Futurama is Zoidberg. Why not Zoidberg? I'm not hearing a no. Just one of my, I mean, it was so fun. Well, when we did the show, everybody loved Zoidberg. And in, you know, and Billy doing the voice of Zoidberg was just absolutely brilliant, and I would just mimic him constantly just to try and get some dueling Zoidbergs going, you know, la 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 la, like, oh, are you gonna eat that sandwich, you know, but yeah, he's hands down one of my favorites. I love Zoidberg. But as far as like recurring character, like characters that would come back and forth, there was Mayor Poopenmeyer always cracked me up. And he had this kind of a voice where he was talking. It was Dave Herman that did it, who also plays Scruffy, who's also one of my favorites.
Scruffy, the janitor.
But Dave Herman, you know who he is. David Herman is Michael Bolton in Office Space. That actor, he's also on like Bob's Burgers and King of the Hill. He was a Mad TV cast member, as was Phil Lamar, who was, you know, who was also in the show as Hermes. And the original Leela was Nicole Sullivan, who was on Mad TV, and they replaced her with Katie. Interesting trivia. There you go. All the Fry memes are so awesome. I love that. Those really really kill me. And Billy originally had no idea what the memes meant or what they were or how culturally significant that they were at the time, and now he is all over it like white on rice. It's so funny. Like he's like, wow, man, I love these memes. This is amazing. But no, Fry's memes are definitely my favorite. That's always awesome. That's always awesome.
And do you have favorite versions of some of the most popular ones, like the "Shut Up and Take My Money" or the "Not Sure If" ones?
The not sure if ones are those are money. Those are absolutely, and those are the ones that he couldn't figure out. Like he didn't understand. So, but then when he figured it out, he was like, "Oh, I get it. Now I understand." And yeah, those are the ones that are the best. My favorite.
So you're saying legitimately, Fry was not sure if when he was thinking about the not sure.
Oh yeah, yeah. No, that's it. No, literally. Yeah, absolutely. Yes, absolutely.
The show got cancelled when it came back. Did you notice any change to the way it was written?
No, none. None. It made me angry. I'll tell you this. It made me angry when fans would say, "Well, it's different. It's not the same. It's the writing is different and all that." That's all BS. It's all nonsense. Same writers. In fact, if there were new writers, they were the writing assistants that became writers on the show, which is true, but everybody had the pedigree. Everybody had the Simpsons pedigree, which is interesting about the new show that we're doing, Disenchantment, for Netflix. A ton of Simpsons and Futurama alumni, and you know, when you work with people like that, they have it's a well-oiled machine. So, you know, Futurama was basically Matt's baby when he did it. And it was easy. For me, like, there's just the clockwork that at which the show worked. It was amazing. It was a solid formula from the get-go, because they'd already done all the homework with The Simpsons. So the framework was just perfectly laid out for us.
If Bender could have anyone as his next romance, who would you bring?
Ooh. If we were still doing Futurama and Bender had a shot at, well, who would I want to, wow. I'd want to have my wife doing it, so I don't get in trouble. Yeah, that's a good one, right? Dodged a bullet on that one, man. That's really fun. Lucy Liu. Lucy Liu, I had in a jar. My wife did an episode of Elementary with her, and she was just my husband says hello from inside. You know, you were inside his body, and she was just like, "What? Wait a minute, Bender, if you try," she'd be like, "Oh my God, that was so much fun." But yeah, I'm being safe. Say my wife, Kate Miller. That's done.
Any favorite fictional robots apart from Bender?
Let's see. I don't know. I always like the old Lost in Space with the danger, Will Robinson, danger. Liked him. God, what other robots? Watch a lot of Westworld. Those are. Oof. That's some crazy. Those are some crazy robots. Gee, well, who else? Johnny Sacco and his flying robot. You guys remember that? I'm aging all of you.
You did just make that one up.
Woo! No, that's not true. Johnny Sacco and his flying robot. It was this show. It was an animated show. It was a live action show from like the late 50s, early 60s from Japan. And it was this big. Google that, man. Johnny Sacco and his flying robot. I loved that show when I was growing up as a kid. It was great. He shot missiles from his hands. He would fly around on the robot. It was awesome. I can't even explain it. It's too much. But yeah, I like the robot from Johnny Sacco and his flying robot. Yeah, I totally remember that. Boom, right there, it came back.
Given everything's better if you put more Bender in it, if you could take any TV show and, however inappropriate, add Bender to, as a character to it.
Oh, wow. Oh, okay. How about... okay. Let's put Bender in Westworld. Why not?
Death to all humans.
Yeah, exactly. He'd kill everybody. He wouldn't even know. He'd kill all the other the hosts. He'd kill everybody. He'd be like, I don't know who's who. You're all gonna die, baby. You know, just a slaughter fest. Yeah, I'd love that. That'd be great. That'd be really funny. Or The Walking Dead. Why not? You know, just like, ooh. So you're dead already? Wait, I don't get it. You're a real meat bag, you know? Sure, Bender could fit in anywhere. Sure, absolutely. Soap opera, what, Telemundo? You can get a telenovela, you know? It's just like, yo soy un macho hermano. Stupid. When will we get to see another dose of Bender? You know, that's a good question because we did that mobile game recently, and in order to promote it, we did basically a radio show of Futurama, and it was interesting because it cost less to do because there was no animation involved. But it was longer than a normal episode. So if we do another mobile game, which I'm sure can happen, we may do another, you know, a radio show to promote the game again. So I don't know. I haven't been approached for anything, but with this show and the amount of times it's been canceled, I don't even know. You whatever. Anything can happen. So I'm fingers crossed. Knock on wood. Carry a rabbit's foot, do whatever you got to do, because that's really it.